Welcome back to After the Fact. I'm Christian Esguera. Joining us now is political analyst Ramon Casimple. He's a former executive director of the Institute for Political and Electoral Reform. Also with us is a political science professor Antonio Contreras of De La Salle University. Good evening, gentlemen, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good evening, Christian.
Okay. Let's talk about the recent statements made, or perhaps insinuations or actuations coming from presidential candidate Isko Moreno, the mayor of Manila. The latest of which, of course, was that he said he's open to endorsing President Duterte if the president would allow him. But to be sure, according to Mayor Moreno, he already has a fourth person to vote for senator in 2022, and that is President Duterte. I'll start with Professor Contreras. What do you think of these actuations? Do you sense that he's trying basically to court President Duterte?
Well, it is kind of disappointing, actually, that he's doing this act, but he doesn't have to do this. From the very beginning, he was very critical of the president. And the reason why he has a base is because that base is basically also critical of the president. And because of this move, he's kind of disrupting a bit the electoral equation. And so politics is addition, of course, we know that. But in this case, it might also lead to some subtraction, because for me, I know people who initially are for him, but are now disappointed. And they say they'd rather move to Lenny, or some of them are even entertaining of going to Bongbong. He wants to get the Duterte, if he wants to get the Duterte vote, the DDS crowd, then he has to be told that not all of the pro-go DDS will go to him. It will probably go somewhere else. So I don't know. You know, it's basically, for me, I'm still thinking, what is the motivation behind this? Is it the one doing this, or is it because there are people in his campaign who think that it is good for him?
Mr. Mr. Casimple, what do you think? What do you think is the motivation or the intention here?
Well, this is election time. I'm not surprised, particularly since Mayor Isko Moreno is, I think, a relatively newcomer in politics. And from what I can see, what he's doing is trying to get us broad and as wide a support as possible. So if somebody supports him, that's good. And it's not taking the action as a bad one. Because if it gets an audience, then I don't know about his tactics, but that kind of behavior is not exactly a surprise.
Okay, but Mr. Casimple, would the Duterte support be good for Isko Moreno's campaign?
Well, Isko Moreno has never been identified with him before. And the basic argument is that during election, you want as wide a base to reach as possible. So, I mean, what would happen to him if he doesn't get support from President Duterte? Bad thing, because he has not had that support before. But if he gets it, or at least part of it, that's a plus.
So basically nothing to lose from your perspective. But according to Professor Contreras, this could also lead to subtraction, not just addition. What do you think, Professor Contreras?
Well, you know, one thing about politicians, when they do this, they think that their voters are machines, that they'll just transfer to whoever they prefer to be allied with. So the assumption is that because Duterte has a loyal base, then therefore if Isko gets the endorsement of President Duterte, that all the supporters of Duterte will move to him. But that is my problem. When you have that kind of analysis and that kind of perspective, you're thinking of the voters as if they're going to act automatically or mechanically or in a predictable way. And I say I think voters don't do that anymore. There are voters, you have to look at the reason why they support you. There are hard Isko Moreno voters and they would vote for him regardless. But there are also soft voters whose votes would be contingent with certain things. Like there are votes for him because they protest and they don't like Duterte. But they don't like Bongbong Marcos. They also don't like Lenny. That's why they like him. And now if Duterte will come and become an ally, become a candidate in the senatorial slate, then what will this soft support be? But on the other side, you can spin that and say that perhaps this is also some kind of a purge, some kind of a test of loyalty. Maybe Isko is doing this to really test how far his voter base can support him, whether it's, well, no matter who is going to be there. But this, that is my point. You know, we have to go beyond the mathematics of transferring yung angat patong ba na iangat mo lang dito ipapatong mo sa isang kandidato, because voters are more, I would assume that voters would be more intelligent than that.
Normally, if an incumbent official is not that popular, an outgoing president, the endorsement is seen as a case of death, right?
Yes.
In the case
yes.
of President Duterte, he's still popular, but he also has a lot of detractors. Safe to say, a lot of people don't like him as well. So do you see that also in this case, that his endorsement, his support for Isko Moreno's candidacy could also end up as a case of death? Mr. Contreras first.
Yes. In fact, if you look at the numbers of the president's numbers are not as high as before. In fact, in the surveys, in some of the surveys, it's not even, you know, he didn't even top the vice presidential race in some surveys. Now, there is no survey yet of the senatorial candidates with him. So it's going to be interesting. But if we're going to gauge it on the basis of the past presidential surveys, the most recent ones, in terms of popularity, approval, and satisfaction, his numbers are kind of still, good, but it's not as high as before. So his base is slowly being eroded. And there are many issues against him now, the family controversy, all these things. You know, it could erode his numbers, and it could also be, as you correctly pointed out, a case of death. And maybe that's why, you know, I even surmise that maybe that's the reason why Bongbong Marcos would rather be better served if Duterte attacks him, so that at least, you know, that could probably be a way of inoculating him. So which is a different angle into this. So kaya nga ako nalilito, but why is Isko doing this? You know, he doesn't have to do this. Okay? But okay. But if he wants to expand his base, the diehard Duterte supporter group may not be the good place to get that number from.
Okay. Mr. Kasiglin, I've seen some comments on social media. Of course, even before, the accusation, fairly or unfairly, hurled against him by other supporters of other candidates was that he was a secret Duterte candidate. And sooner or later, they were anticipating that he would unravel. Do you think this is what is happening also now, in the case of Mayor Isko Moreno being more openly in support of President Duterte, also despite everything that the president had been saying against him recently, Mr. Casita?
Well, I don't think so. The more simpler or the simpler actually reason is that he wants to get votes wherever he can get it, and if he can get it from Duterte's base, I don't think he would shy away from that. I mean, it's election time, so he wants to get votes from us. Wide a circle as possible. If I knew his tactics, that kind of tactics is, you want to be, near to all people. Mm-hmm. So that's one way to do it.
But do you think, Mr. Casimiro, that approach by Mayor Isko Moreno would actually work? The simple idea that politics is addition, given the complications and nuances of the current landscape?
Of course not. It's a little bit problematic if there is really an issue against Duterte, which by your questioning up to him will become a problem. And he will lose vote. He will also add vote. That is for him to look if what he gets from what he is doing will get him more votes than what he loses. And we don't know yet at this time. It's too early to say that.
Okay. Mr. Contreras, I think we've heard this before from Mayor Isko Moreno. He wanted to present himself as someone in the middle, an option if between, let's say, the Marcos camp or the Robredo side. He wants to present himself as someone in the middle. Friends to all, perhaps. Siguro in international relations, para equidistant, if he wants to portray himself that, no? But so far, based on his actuations, his narrative, do you think he's succeeding in that respect?
Well, if he wants to be in the middle, then he should not be openly preferring someone, a specific someone. You have to be friends to everyone. So that means including the Marcos loyalists and the yellows and the pinks. You have to be friends with anyone and not to say that you'd like to vote for Duterte, knowing that Duterte is a divisive figure. But, you know, I think he tried to be in the middle, and I think he would have succeeded if he was in the middle in terms of a platform. This is something that he can sell to all people. He can sell to, and he started with saying that he wants to end the conflict. He wants to stop this bickering between the DDS and the yellows, between Marcos and the Liberal Party. He wants to stop that. And if he could have substantiated that with policy, concrete policies that will help people regardless of what your political loyalties are, then that could have been a better narrative for him, rather than trying to woo different candidates, personalities, hoping that they will bring to him the voter base of these candidates. Mm-hmm. A unification that is more substantive would have been a better way for Isko, rather than a unification of trying to bring in different kinds of political personalities. It will still be personality driven, mm-hmm. which is basically what he was against from the very beginning.
Okay. Mr. Casimple, could this also be regarded as a pivot at this stage of the campaign by the Moreno camp? So also as a response to the numbers that we saw in the last survey in favor of Bongbong Marcos. And in that same survey, Lenny Robredo ranked second, and a third place was Isko Moreno. Can this be seen as a pivot?
Well,
Mr. Casimple,
I don't... We couldn't say for certain the reason for the tactic, but since the direction is towards broadening the base or broadening his possible support, then that maybe is the reason for his I would say wild. It's a little bit wild approach. You don't go to other candidates or to other personalities without any reason. I mean, you have to have a reason that you can explain to the voting public why you are doing that. It's too early to say, but there's still a lot of things that could be done, but he has not done actually still.
Okay. Professor Contreras, what do you think?
Well, a part of me would like to say that it is basically a strategy. He really wants to increase his numbers because, as you correctly pointed out, he is number three right now in the survey. And based from whether it's a scientific survey or the non-scientific survey, that Bongbong Marcos is really, you know, so far away. You know, in fact, the last survey that I saw, it was even like two-digit away, you know, about 50%. You know, they're also saying that, you know, there is this rumor about another research, that a survey that's been embargoed, where he had 82% on whether that's real news or fake news. But one thing is certain, in my personal conversations with people on the street, because I do that, and indeed Marcos is at the front, and then Isko and Lenny are slugging it out for the second, but a far distant second and third. So they have to do something to increase their numbers. And these are desperate moves. So probably it's also a sign of desperation, a sign of doing something that perhaps kung mangyari to, maganda resulta, good. Pag hindi, you have nothing to lose. You're second or third anyway. So maybe that's it. So, but the point is, there are many things happening already, even if the campaign hasn't started yet. Okay?
Officially.
But many things are starting already. You know, in the past, nag-warm up pa lang itong mga to, nag-detest pa lang ng waters, trial balloons. But now, this is part of the whole entire campaign. And so it's interesting. So I don't know what will happen. Matagal pa ang Pebrero, di ba? Ano pa? Dalawang buwan pa. So hindi natin alam kung ano mangyayari. Will someone drop out of the race? We don't know. Somebody did already, Bongo. Will there be a second one or a third one? We don't know. But one thing, wala nang madadagdag yan unless someone is disqualified and is replaced by a person of the same surname. But that is only the other equation that will be changing this entire election that has become like a one big, big race that is so unpredictable, so interesting.
Okay. Mr. Kasipe. Mr. Kasipe, can this also be regarded as a gamble, or could this also be seen as risky on the part of Mayor Isko Moreno? The fact that he was the one that opened the idea of endorsing President Duterte, and in fact, personally, he would vote for him for senator. And what if, let's say, the offer or the opening was not reciprocated by the president?
Well, it's not yet a risky time. And these are the tactics that you want to basically look if it's capable of turning any possible group of voters or other candidates. But certainly, these are not yet serious attempts, in the sense that he would lose much or gain much. I would rather see this as trying various tactics. So one at a time, they're trying, not only him, but other candidates are also doing this, trying out several tactics.
Ensure
it's
that,
not the time for serious tacticizing.
In short, dahil maaga pa yung kampanya, parang they can afford to do some trial and error if you're a candidate.
In the sense, yes.
Okay. But, Professor Contreras, of course, this is a time when people can also still speculate. So, dito for instance, I'm talking about the idea of risk here. They think this decision by Mayor Isko Moreno to basically try to court support from the Duterte group is also driven by the fact that President Duterte, so far as we know it, is left with no presidential candidate. And the last word that he had given toward the Marcos group was that he was criticizing him. Well, so, is that the opening?
That's a reality. President Duterte has no presidential candidate right now because Bongo withdrew. And so you have the government machinery up for grabs. It's going to be and that's a big machinery. So there is a possibility that Isko would look at that as a possibility that if he snares the endorsement of the president, he will get not only the support of the DDS, but also the government resources. That's one way of looking at it.
But is that transferable? Is that even transferable?
But that is my next point. Is it transferable? Is the base of Duterte and Bongo transferable? And that is why I tend to go back to my earlier point. The way I look at the electoral math is that I just don't look at the behavior of candidates. We have been analyzing politics from the perspective of the candidates. We have to look at it from the perspective of what is going on the ground. These voters, the voters that we look now, are voters that are existing at the time when social media is very active. news is immediate, almost real time, that they actively participate in the shaping of political and electoral discourse through their posts in social media. They are some street level analysts, but you just have to Google and then they post their views. So we have a different political landscape right now from the perspective of the voters. And this is something that is a new thing in the dynamics. Voters are no longer just the thing that is, you know, follow like an herd, yung herd mentality, you know, this black voting as if they're passive. That's, if you're going to use that, then you are taking a very big risk. And so the point is, it still goes back to the issue. Maybe it's an act of desperation, an act of testing everything that will work. Because at the end of the day, you are facing a huge firewall of a Bongbong Marcos surge that this very early, that the only way you can now hope is that he gets disqualified or something dramatic happens to him. Because right now, you know, after all these things, binato na kay Bongbong lahat, binato na sa kanya ang kanyang degree, binulit-ulit na sa media ang kanyang martial law affiliation, ang kanyang pamilya, it doesn't work. So itong disqualification, naandyan pa yan. Pag hindi rin ito mag-work, you know, then it's going to be very hard for the second and the third and the fourth placer. So it's scrambling. It's almost like a game of Survivor that, you know, there is a very strong player that you have to oust and then you have to scramble. Okay. So you have to take big moves, big risks, because the payoff will be big. But okay, if you lose, at least you tried.
Okay. Professor Antonio Contreras and Mr. Ramon Casimple, thank you, gentlemen, for joining us tonight on the program.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguera. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now, for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel. Catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the panel.